were started full-time at the age of 14, graduated with a degree in mechanical engineering at the age of 19. From there, from that point of graduating with my degree, then I started working for the United States Navy as the youngest weapon systems engineer for the U.S. Navy. Right? I said all that to say I used to work on blowing things up for the United States Navy. Did that for about 5 years. During that time, I worked as an innovation manager. So I managed multiple projects that helped bring the new and the best kind of products out to the Navy. Sound good? Afterwards, I said, what am I going to do with my life, right? And I'm 23, 24, yeah, about 23, 24 around that time. I'm like, what am I going to do with my life? I've reached where I wanted to be in my career. It's like, what's next, right? So I decided to go to law school. I started law school. During my first year, I realized, I need a little something more to occupy my time in addition to law school. So I started the MBA program. So it's my second year. I'm doing law and I'm doing the MBA program. And I'm like, whoa. And fast forward, 2016, I graduate with my law degree. And in May 11th, I'll be graduating with my MBA. So, a little brief history about myself. Like I said, I've been at Southern University since 2013, and now it's 2018. Seems like 5 years can go by so fast. Seems like 5 years is so long, but 5 years goes by so fast. So is that a good introduction? All right, perfect. Now, so today we're wondering, what is Montgomery coming up here to come talk about? And today we're gonna talk about Black Panther. But before we get knee deep into our discussion, what I wanna know from you is who's your favorite character, maybe a why, and maybe, who's your favorite character and why, and maybe your favorite scene out of the movie. Go ahead, brother.
T'Challa, and towards the end, when they fell.
Please state your name and your major.
Class Charles Saunders. My major is financing. Favorite character would be T'Challa. My favorite part of the movie was towards the end when they fell underground. And as I was watching, I noticed they were underground. They were fighting on the railroad, and I found that symbolic. So that would be my favorite part.
Good morning. My name is Taylor G. Lewis. I'm a mass communications major with a minor in marketing. And my favorite character was Nakia because I admired her want to help. And my favorite scene was whenever Killmonger was in the museum and he told the museum lady, he was like, "You don't think white people made that?" Yeah, that's my favorite part. That's so true. It was so woke. So.
Absolutely.
I'm a business management major and transitioning into a concentration in marketing. And my favorite character was Michael B. Jordan, so Killmonger. For the most shallowest reason is because he's just so fine. And he's a great actor.
Absolutely.
And my favorite scene, I don't know, there was like multiple. I like the scene where they were in the Lexuses and actually like driving. And also I did like also the museum scene because that was hilarious. Like,
interesting.
You really thought? Okay.
Interesting. I like that. Go ahead.
Hi, I'm Paige Templeton. I'm a marketing major. I'm a sophomore. My favorite character would be Okoye. She's actually on screen. And my favorite, she was just resilient no matter who was serving her. I think she had made a statement saying that, it doesn't matter who my leader is. I am going to, serve them. That's her duty. So she was resilient. And my favorite scene was when they were fighting, and I guess it was, what do they call the big animal?
The rhino.
What's her right? Okay.
Absolutely.
Was trying, I guess, like he was like sending it for her to, I guess, tackle her, and it stopped, and like she kissed it, so it respected her, I guess, or something like that.
Absolutely.
They're in a relationship.
Yeah. Absolutely. If anybody knew, then rhinoceros knew. Go ahead, brother.
Thank you.
My name is Saki Thomas. I'm a business management major, a freshman, and my favorite character was T'Challa because I like the leadership role that he played in Wakanda.
Absolutely. Hello, Queen. Hello, King. Hello, Queen. How are you?
First row. First to second row.
Hello, my name is Malik Steels. I'm a pair of merchandising textile major. My favorite character was Siri, my sister, just because she was like extremely intelligent. intelligent.
Absolutely.
I just thought that was amazing how she made everything. Like, nothing would have went on without her. Like, she made the railroad tracks down to the communication way down to the suit. Like, she was making everything. So I just thought that was pretty cool. And then my favorite part of the movie was when they had went back to, like, resurrect them. And the white man was trying to talk, and all the people just thought like barking, not trying to let him talk. Like, that was my favorite part of it.
Absolutely.
Hello, my name is Shauna Alcott. I'm a nursing major with a minor in business and psychology. My favorite character was, I don't know her name.
General Okoye.
Yeah, General Okoye, because she was like she said, she was loyal no matter who was on the throne. And just kept sticking by and stuck to her morals. And then my favorite part was when they were talking to Killmonger, like they had captured him, and the white guy, the FBI agent, had touched Prince. And she's like, if he touches you again, I'm gonna kill him.
Yeah, absolutely. Absolutely.
My name is Alfred. I made the business management.
Absolutely. Absolutely. Good morning.
My name is Norman Bradford. I'm a business management major, and I've never seen the movie.
You ever seen the movie?
Okay.
We're going to get to you then.
General Okoye. General Okoye, she was loyal the whole time. His sister, she was very passionate about her technology. The girlfriend?
Nakia,
she was passionate about helping refugees, so I like her now. But my favorite part of the movie was when
General Okoye.
General Okoye had, they was all fighting each other, and her husband and boyfriend was like, would you kill me, my love? And she was like, oh, Wakanda.
Cocaine, right? Cocaine.
It stopped. I was like, yes.
Cocaine. Go ahead.
Also, my favorite part was at the end when he actually finally decided he would try to improve, implement programs to help improve that neighborhood. Because I was like, that's great, because that's kind of like the, I don't know, I just like that.
Beautiful. Go ahead.
That's why I like probably the most. I understood Killmonger's, his anger. I understood it. But the fact that he took his dad about it, like, we need to help our people. And he did it because Wakanda was like, sat back and watched everything. And the fact that T'Challa wanted to help others, that's what made me like the most.
Absolutely. Go ahead.
I think also my other favorite part was like in the beginning of the movie when it just started off and it said Oakland, California, because that's originally where I'm from. So
you from the town?
Like, yeah.
Okay. That's lovely. I got folks in the town and from the ridge.
For real?
Yeah.
Yeah, I'm from North Oakland.
All my family's from.
North Oakland.
East. Absolutely. So great. I'm glad to hear this. You know why?
Cat 1-4.
Oh, absolutely. Good morning, King!
How are you?
I'm blessed, how are you?
I'm doing great.
Great, please introduce yourself.
My name is Harvey Dixon.
Okay, walking chew gum. Introduce yourself, tell me what your favorite character is. Have you seen Black Panther?
Yeah.
All right, tell me who your favorite character is. Tell me why. Go ahead and have a seat. Walking chew gum. Tell me who's your favorite character, why is your favorite character, and your favorite scene out of the movie.
I would say my favorite character is T'Challa. Not Killmonger, but my, like, why he's my favorite character?
Yes.
I feel he has qualities that are similar to my own.
Beautiful.
Like, personality-wise, so.
Beautiful.
And my favorite scene was the fight scene when it was, like, on the little train station or whatever at the end of the movie.
So we got two train stations, right? Two at the museum.
How you caught that?
Two or three at the museum. One that when they were dying, when he was dying, right? One where we were driving the Lexus. Another one where we're getting resurrected, right? One when we're at the beginning of the movie, right, showing Oakland. You said
the refugees
the refugees and the rhinoceros. Did I cover all of them? Oh, and when she said, "Will you kill me for Wakanda? Will you kill me, my love?" She said, "For Wakanda." You know, they're like, "Man, I thought that was cold." Like, you know what I'm saying? So definitely was some art. You're gonna be the one to go do some art. So beautiful, beautiful. Now we want to come into our discussion about, was that a black movie? Was Black Panther a black movie?
It's a movie for us. I mean, it was for everybody, but.
Okay, it was for everybody. Go ahead.
I feel like before it released, like, people were putting more into it as, like, it's going to be, like, a black power movie. Mm-hmm. Even though there were still elements of it, it was still a superhero movie at the end of the day.
It's part of Marvel.
So, part of Marvel, right? We had invocations of black power, black strength, right? Black greatness, right? Black excellence, correct?
Yes.
Huh. But it was a movie made for everybody, yet it...
Related to us.
Yeah.
So we see that it was marketed to everybody, but it seems like there were specific messages.
Yeah, their target market
to
get black or African Americans to go to the movie, like us to go to the movie. Because I know with a lot of the Marvel, like other movies, it's not really us that you see in the theater, I guess is the way to say it. Like, they don't follow the whole storyline from like Captain America, Thor, Iron Man, Hulk, all those movies. This one was more targeted towards us, and like it was predominantly African Americans who were starting movies, not white people or Asians or whoever else.
Absolutely. You were going to say something.
I think it's a black movie just because the roles, I mean, it's been a while since it's been like literally a whole entire black cast, like, and they said that there was black people behind the scenes everywhere, like on the set. And everything, so I think it's a black movie personally, just because of that fact, and also just because, like, it was Black Panther. Like, you seen like what, two or three white people the whole time, and most of them was villains.
Absolutely.
Like, so.
Absolutely.
I believe it.
We're gonna touch on those points. Go ahead. Wait, you came in late. Go ahead.
Oh. So shaky. I feel personally that it was a black movie because overall what you see is something that we can all relate to with the difference between Killmonger and T'Challa, because like Killmonger was raised in the hood, fatherless, well, partially because, like, you know, he got killed, but he was fatherless and he was raised in that more hood area, so he had to learn how to fend for himself out in Oakland, while T'Challa is over here getting everything he needs, spoon fed, all that. And it's like, that's something that all people in the black community can kind of relate to, because some of us have a better lifestyle than, like, say our cousins. And it's like that boundary right there that makes the conflict in our own neighborhoods, in our own communities, and just between each other.
We want to talk about that. Go ahead. You don't get left out. You just get put in a different order.
I'm cool with
you. All right, perfect. I just wanted to let you know. Go ahead.
I don't know if anybody else has like read the comics or like anything, but like the reason why there's so many black people is because the area that they're in. So it's not necessarily like, I wouldn't say it's a black movie, because you gotta like look at, do your research. This came, Black Panther came out when the blacks, I don't know how you say it, like the blacksification or whatever.
Blacksportation.
Blacksportation area. So you gotta understand like the background behind it. But when you look at what Ryan Coogler did with it, whenever you look at like the director's cut or even like some of his interviews, he did slip some subliminal messages into it, whether it be like a certain scene where people are positioned. It's like different stuff, but I wouldn't say necessarily like it's a black movie. There's more movies that talk about black pride than Black Panther per se. This is still a superhero movie at the end of the day. People are just gonna get behind it because they're like, oh, all black cast, but you gotta understand why it's an all black cast too at the end of the day.
Beautiful, beautiful. I'm gonna move on. Go ahead.
I'm gonna pick it back up from him, because, you know, I feel as though white people do the same thing when they make their movies. They don't call it a white movie. It's a movie for everybody to watch. It's just a movie for people in the movie are white. But the thing about it is, I don't think so many people thought that an all black cast can make this much of a movement and make so much money.
Beautiful. We're gonna move on. But I'm gonna get to it. I'm gonna make sure to get to you. You see strong, powerful, dangerous black women. Agree?
Mm-hmm.
If anything, when's the last time you've seen an image like this?
Like, my mama, was she mad at me?
I heard that, but the spirits might not be up. Might be actually pointing at you. right? Okay, so we're talking about marketing. We're talking about I'm marketing to you, but I might also be messaging you as well. Agreed? Mm-hmm. So even though I have marketed to everybody, there are particular messages that only you will get. How he had talked about Ryan Coogler putting different things within the movie that were symbols, right? From the club scene where they're in red, black, and green, right? Marcus Garvey, right? Back to Africa movement. So when we start seeing these things, it's like, hey, you're talking to me. But could I also be talking to somebody else? 73%, according to Nielsen's, 73 of non-Hispanic whites believe that African Americans influence mainstream culture. Do you agree, yes or no?
Yes. Yes.
Influence it, right? Do we control it?
No.
Small screen influence on pop culture. This is another study from Nielsen. But I want to take note. What does it say? African American women, our science, her magic. So here it is on the screen. We see black women on the screen. Do you think that movie was targeted towards black men or black women?
Wait, you're talking about Black Panther?
Black Panther. Mm-hmm.
Black women,
right?
Yeah, I really feel like black women.
Black women, right?
They were kind of like taking control over everything. Like, the storyline was between T'Challa and Killmonger, but women were like running.
Yeah, they had
absolutely,
all the power.
Absolutely, all the power, which is symbolic of what goes on in many African tribes during ancient African tribes, where women were in charge, and even it's sometimes to this day as well. But we're going to talk about that also. Anybody watch Blackish? Right, raise your hand, who watched Blackish? 80% non-African viewers, non-African-American viewers, 20% African-American viewers. What? What? Rosewood, How to Get Away with Murder. Atlanta, 50% non-African-American viewers, 50% African-American viewers. Empire, 37%, 62%. But you would think something like Blackish.
More positive.
Family friendly.
Yeah, family
friendly.
What is This Is Us? That one show with people.
Well, who's in This Is Us? Starting Kate Brown.
Yes.
Yeah. And who's also in Black Panther, who played in Njoku. Right? So what I wanted to show with this chart was that even though it looks like it may be for us and possibly even by us, that for us may not necessarily be quite true. So I've marketed to you, I've messaged to you, but there's other messages that are in there as well. Because if you're not the only one watching it, then I have to give messages to everyone else. Agree? When I go back to this image, you as somebody black, you as somebody oppressed, you as somebody who has been part of a historically oppressed people, let me rephrase that. Yes, a historically oppressed people, symbols of empowerment. But what about the people who don't speak English who are just now watching the movie and see these images of black women with spears who are armed? What do you think that does to them?
Make them fearful.
Fearful. Are they not? Are people already not fearful of black people already?
They are.
So what do they tell us? They tell us, go get an education. You know, then all of a sudden you find out that your education makes you a threat. Right? They tell you to do something different with your hair so that you won't be a threat, right? And they find some issue with that. So what I'm talking about is this can't win for losing. Heard of that before? So I lose things so that hopefully I can win in one area, and it seems that we give these things up and continue to lose. So even with me looking powerful, right, I have to be conscious. I'm told to be conscious of, hey, that's too aggressive. That's too aggressive, but look at the movie. Look at the images that are on the screen. So now, even though all of us are being marketed to, what are the different messages that you're getting? Food for thought. So move on. Who is the Black Panther?
That's Huey P.
That's Huey P. Member of Phi Beta Sigma Fraternity Incorporated. My fraternity as well. Came out of Oakland, California. But go ahead. Who's the real Black Panther? Or who is all the Black Panthers, or who is not a Black Panther up there?
Talking about like the superhero Black Panther?
Black Panther in general.
Oh.
Oh, in the middle. Yeah.
Okay. All right. So is this the Black Panther?
Well, he got on the suit, so yeah, he is technically.
Is this the Black Panther?
Yes.
Is this the Black Panther?
No.
How many say yes?
I don't know.
You do one in there for me.
I know his background. I'm not sure he's a
yes or no.
No.
No. We're all hands for no.
Oh, look at y'all.
I appreciate the brave ones. Go ahead.
I think it depends on my definition of Black Panther.
Give me a definition of Black Panther.
Well, I think Jackie Robinson in the game of baseball, he completely changed the game. So, T'Challa changed the game too whenever he was going to bring vibranium to the U.S. outside of Wakanda.
I got some vibranium for you right now. Black Panther, Black Panther Party for Self-Defense out of Oakland, California, out of the Bay Area, right? Some would call them a vigilante group. I call them revolutionaries who are doing the best for their community.
My grandma was a Black Panther.
So was mine.
Dope.
She interacted with Malcolm X.
Dope. Mm-hmm. What they do not tell you is that the Black Panther Party for Self-Defense got their name from the 761st Tank Battalion. The Black Panthers of World War II, the first Black tank battalion in the United States Army. Their motto was come out fighting. First Lieutenant Jack Lee Robinson was an officer in the 761st Tank Battalion, the Black Panthers. So now you learned a little bit of history. So when we think of these images, we also get homages and symbolisms of what has been. We come all the way from here to get to here where we're now portraying Black Panthers on screen. Had anybody heard of the 761st Tank Battalion? Often not. Did you know that they trained here in Louisiana? Crazy, right? All this history here in Louisiana, Black history, and we don't even know it. And then come to find out that something that a movie that was based upon a revolutionary party was based upon a revolutionary fighting unit in the United States Army. As he said, as our brother said earlier, that this was made during the Blaxploitation era, during the Civil Rights era. The character of Black Panther. Black Panther created by somebody white or somebody black?
White.
White.
White. So here it is, because I have a character that's created about you, but you're not playing in. I am so glad that you said that. I am a member of the NAACP, the National Association for the Advancement of Colored People. Mm-hmm. I've been a member since 2010. I used to work for the NAACP, as a matter of fact. The NAACP had black executive directors, but never president until like 1984. Mm-hmm. And the organization was started in 1909. So here it is, an organization that you think is for you, by you, but not ran by you. So yes, you had the executive director, but you always had somebody that was usually Jewish running the show. Crazy, right? Crazy. Oh, thank you, Dr. Bob.
Remote driver system activated.
Wait! Which side of the road is it?
For bus sake, just drive.
You've been taking good at charging it up with kinetic energy.
Exciting scene in the movie, isn't it? Mm-hmm. Very exciting scene in the movie. Why did I play that clip?
The Lexus.
Oh man, Lexus. The Lexus. The Lexus. What do we call that when somebody puts their product? Places their product in your home. Oh my goodness, I'm working with Black Scholars. I tell you, man, it's such a great day to be at Southern University. Absolutely, product placement. Out of everything that was in the movie, the only thing that I saw that was product placement was that car. Anybody else see anything else?
The 4Runners that they were using, that was a recognizable car, and they're also really good cars on speed and on
Off-road.
So the fact that the Lexus is kind of like competing with it, that really was really nice.
Beautiful. So, who makes Lexus?
Aren't they like the more expensive Toyota?
Yes, they are.
Yeah.
Pardon? Lexus is Asian. Yes. Yeah. Yes, Japanese. Yes, Toyota. So, funny thing, there is no Lexus in Japan. It's just Toyotas. Mm-hmm.
When they brought Toyota Tacomas over in 2004, my dad was one of the first people to get them.
Beautiful, mm-hmm. Beautiful, beautiful. So I put this clip in here to talk about this. Product placement, as we had talked. Ain't that something? Beautiful. Doesn't that car look nice? Mm-hmm. I think it looks nice as well.
I know it's
So let's talk. We said that I asked you a question earlier. Do you think that this movie was marketed more towards Black women or towards Black men? And we said
Black women.
And we said
Black women.
And we said
Black women.
Black women. All right. So if we have Black women are being marketed to, wouldn't I have a Black woman driving
in the car?
Yeah. Right.
Of course.
Right. Could you see yourself sitting in the seat of a brand new Lexus? Can you? Can you?
Yeah, I can.
Yeah, you probably. I saw you drift off into the sunset. So, ooh, I'm gonna be in the car like this, have a seat back where I need to have it. Absolutely. Was it by accident or by purpose?
Purpose.
Okay. Why do you think it was by purpose?
Because we have the buying power.
Oh my goodness. Okay. So I don't spend $200 million on a movie. Right? Mm-hmm. To make a movie, just to make a movie, right? Mm-hmm. And I then don't spend another $140 to $150 million to market it for nothing, right? Mm-hmm. According to Nielsen's, 54% of Black women, the first thing that they want in their car is for that car to be fun. Did that car look fun?
Yes.
53% of Black women say that performance and acceleration is a major factor in their buying decision of a car. Did that car have giddy up?
Yes.
Absolutely. Styling was a top consideration for 56% of Black women. Is that a stylish car? Mm-hmm. Now, this particular car is the LC500. Doing some research, found out this car is $92,000.
Oh,
okay. 92, right? When I go to Black Panther and I see this car, I'm like, I'm Googling that car as soon as I get out the theater, right? Mm-hmm. Or I decide I'm gonna stop by a Lexus dealership. I go up to this car and I see, that's the car from Black Panther. I walk up, I see the stick, I say, y'all got anything else? And what does the Lexus dealer say? Oh, sure, we got plenty of fun, cars with giddy up that look good, right within your price range. If I'm looking to market towards Black women, I know that Black women are the most highly educated group in America. Therefore, we tie education with income and earning capacity. So that means that you're going to be part of the top earners and top income producers here in the United States. So therefore, if I have product and I need to get that product in your hands, I need to put images in front of you that look like you, that say, hey, get you a new Lexus. Oh, you like T'Challa? You saw the way T'Challa's on the hood, right? Yeah, that you can have your own little T'Challa, your own little Lexus. Now we're getting into another part of the discussion, this part of the discussion that I really like. Okay, let's get How many like T'Challa? To say T'Challa is their favorite character? 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. Five people said T'Challa is their favorite character. Okoye. You like Okoye too? That's why you could have multiple characters.
Oh, yeah.
How many like Killmonger? Killmonger.
Michael B. Jordan.
Yeah. Absolutely. Okay, now watch this. I'm gonna put something on you. We say autochthonous African versus American Africans or African American citizens. Now me as somebody that's in the law, of course I'm gonna overcomplicate things. Right? I'm gonna find that there's nuance within words. I'm gonna strip every nuance out the word. So therefore, when I say American African, I say I identify as African. What kind of African am I? One that was born in America. What does autochthonous mean?
From Africa.
Or indigenous.
Yeah,
born on the continent. Right? Born on the continent or indigenous. So therefore I can say that somebody that says that they're Nigerian or they're Senegalese and say, oh, I'm African. I said, me too. And they look at me like I'm crazy. I'm like, what do you mean you're African? I said, okay, well, how long does it take for the tree to leave its roots? Well, I know where I came from, right? Came from Africa. My descendants I descended from enslaved people, enslaved Africans. So, therefore, I'm African. I may not necessarily be autochthonous African, but then don't stop me from being African. What was the debate between T'Challa and, excuse me, I don't really like referring to him as Killmonger. I like referring to him as N'Jaka, his Wakanda name, because he was Wakanda, mm-hmm. Right? What was the debate between T'Challa and N'Jaka? What was that debate?
I don't know if it was necessarily a debate, but I know that he was, they felt that maybe he was less deserving of it, maybe so, as far as like the throne goes, that maybe he didn't deserve it because he wasn't
pure
theirs or
yeah, wasn't
exactly.
Raised there.
Because his mom I guess his mom was African American, but she was originally in America, and his dad mixed that up, so.
Absolutely. Go ahead.
What was going more than for, like, they had the same messages. Tyler wanted to help, but what'd you call him again?
N'Jaka.
N'Jaka wanted, he also wanted to help, but he wanted to do it like a Hitler type of way.
In a what?
Hitler type of way.
Like an aggressive.
Maybe. Okay. All right.
More aggressive. Yeah.
Maybe. Okay.
I'm not saying like take over.
No, I'm with you. I'm with you. But I'm going to challenge you is when you get a chance, read Mein Kampf.
How you spell that?
MEIN. KAMPF. It's always good to know about the people, to know about the people that we talk about. Always good, right? So why would I talk about the Black Panther Party for self-defense and I don't read none of Huey P. Newton stuff? Right? What kind of sense would that make? Right? I can listen to what everybody else tells me about that person, but when I read what they have to say in their own words, gives me a different perspective, gives me where their mind is at, right? Which one would you rather have? Somebody tell somebody else about you, or that person come and talk to you directly? Come talk to me directly. Don't start no rumors, right? Get it from me. Then what everybody else has to say, you make your own decision. T'Challa, right? Both highly educated,
mm-hmm.
Wakandan royalty,
mm-hmm.
Right? Highly educated or no?
He was highly educated.
How highly educated?
He graduated college like super early and then he went into the military. I don't remember exactly.
MIT.
Who you think I identified with? Who do you think I identified with?
Killmonger
or N'Jaka, right? Here it is somebody who was robbed of their father,
mm-hmm.
by his dad,
mm-hmm.
right? Robbed of his father, but went to graduate college at 19, right, from the United States. Did he go to the Naval Academy?
Annapolis.
Yep, the United States Naval Academy in Annapolis. Before I went to, before while I was in college, I had an opportunity to go to the United States Air Force Academy. The congressman wrote me after I left the Air Force Academy and said, "If you want to go, all you gotta do is write me a letter and let me know. I'll get your letter of recommendation." right? So graduated in 19, then went on to MIT. Anybody heard of MIT?
Mm-hmm.
Right? If you're in STEM, basically anything, MIT is right up here. Got two degrees, two doctors, correct? Two doctorates. So that means that not only was this man deadly, but he could also teach at the best universities in the world. Right, let me add this to it. So then after that, he goes on to join the Navy SEALs, right? Navy SEALs we know as being the best of the best, correct? Then he goes on and joins another unit called JSOC, which is Joint Special Operations Command. That means the best of the best from all the different services. They go and create a team and then go do their thing. So is this brother bad or was this brother bad?
Bad,
right? So now you have somebody who has not had his father there, right? His father was, let me rephrase that. His father was taken from him in a very rough place. Oakland, during the 80s, right? Oakland during the 80s. Now coming back to come get his birthright. And he's seen as an outsider. Are there any similarities between what we see with autochthonous Africans today and American Africans today?
Yes.
So we see similarities. We see parallels, right? We see homages. One of the homages that we see, the relationship between American Africans and autochthonous Africans, correct? We talked about that one. Hey, Auntie.
Oh my gosh, that was my favorite part.
Right? Hey, Auntie, and come to find out, he ad-libbed that part. But it spoke to so many of us because it's like, hey man, like, we're supposed to be brothers, we're supposed to be cousins, right? Cousins, first cousins. The relationship of white folks between American Africans and autochthonous Africans. Remember the CIA agent?
Mm-hmm.
T'Challa brought the CIA agent back to Wakanda. What you doing bringing a spy into Wakanda? You're supposed to be isolationist.
You call him a colonizer?
Call him a colonizer.
Mm-hmm.
But you could have left the colonizer in Korea. But you bring him to Wakanda.
Amazing.
What are some of the parallels between allowing white folks, colonizers, into Africa? Do we see similarities? Do we see a historical pattern?
Mm-hmm.
What about the relationship of white folks to American Africans? I'm gonna add to it. In Africa, white folks colonized. Agree?
Yeah.
In America, white folks enslaved and dehumanized people. The Africans in Africa were fighting in their own land against an invader whom they outnumbered. Africans in America were fighting in a strange and foreign land against an enslaver and a rapist who outnumbered them. Different relationships, therefore, different interaction with white people, and not all white folks were the same, right? We saw the CIA agent versus we saw Ulysses S. Claw. One thing about Ulysses S. Claw is he was from Belgium. Well, what were the Belgians known for? Anybody heard of King Leopold?
Yeah, it was terrible. That was the worst one.
King Leopold, right? Why isn't King Leopold referred to as Hitler? King Leopold killed 10 million on a conservative estimate. 10 million Congolese people, African people, prior to World War II. Do you hear anything about King Leopold? No. Guess where King Leopold was from? Belgium. So here it is, we have real history. We've been taught to think this way about people, but we ain't been taught to think about this way about our true enemies. Give you something to think about. Let me say something about the reason why Ndjaka was my favorite, was let's say my favorite character, but let me take Ndjaka and T'Challa both within the same frame. Flawed men. Agree?
Mm-hmm.
Immature. Driven by rage and revenge.
Mm-hmm.
Right? I wouldn't say there's anything wrong with being driven by rage. Well, I say driven by rage, but I wouldn't say that there's anything wrong with anger or rage in general. It's how you direct it,
mm-hmm.
right? How you direct it. The reason why I say that is because to tell you something just happened to you and for me to tell you to not be angry, that's like telling you to deny a piece of your humanity. Don't be mad. What you mean? Imagine something just happened to you. Somebody tell you don't be mad. How just more steaming you got. Like, man, you don't understand what just happened to me. Right? T'Challa is supposed to be king, and he brings in a foreign spy. Behavior of a king? He ends up winning ritual combat and then burns the heart-shaped herb. Anybody heard of the debate between, it was like, they made parallels between Malcolm X and Martin Luther King?
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Between them? I don't subscribe to that train of thought.
I thought that was supposed to be for X.
There were similarities, right. Absolutely.
Magneto was Malcolm X, and Professor X was Martin Luther King.
Absolutely.
And the mutants were us, black people, trying to exist in America, and how the people that are not humans looked at black people, and black people were the mutants.
Absolutely. Thank you for bringing that up. So, as he said, in the Marvel Universe, talking about the similarities between Professor X and Magneto and Martin Luther King and Malcolm X. Most time when you think of Malcolm, you think of that kind of character. Agreed?
Agreed. Mm-hmm.
What's he got in his hand? And a sword, correct? Mm-hmm. What's he got in his hand?
A shield.
Shield and a spear. Anybody seen Shaka Zulu?
Been a while. I was
just watching that last week. Seen Shaka Zulu? Remember this, when Shaka Zulu, during his like first battle, then broke the spear, and it's about that same length? Absolutely. Then remember when in Shaka, there's another scene in Shaka Zulu where Shaka Zulu has his captain kill his firstborn. And he says, there will be none after me. Mm-hmm. What's the similarity between that?
To the Purple Heart.
To the Purple Heart. Right, so we have these homages that are within the movie, but not even recognize just how much of that messaging is coming full circle, right? If you went to go watch Shaka Zulu now, you'd be like, oh, I saw the same thing in Black Panther, right? Oh, this right here was talking about the salaries of the main actors in Black Panther. Do you know how much they in total got paid? Throw out a number.
10 million. 7?
10 million, go ahead.
15,
go ahead.
I would say like.
Go ahead, anybody else? 8.3.
Wow. That's a lot of money.
No, in total.
I mean.
That's not separate, that's in total.
That's total.
Oh, no. Across the board?
Yeah.
That's worth the
money. They split.
Oh no!
8.3 million for the black actors. Okay,
how much did they surpass Titanic?
At this
point,
please make it resentful, money. I would hope so. So what does that mean? That means that I spent $200 million on the movie, right? I paid you 10. Just say 10 for easy math. I ended up making $1 billion. So let's go from 10 million, right? Let's, 10 million to a billion. We have 10 million. We have 100 million. 1 billion. So for every dollar that I paid you, I made 100. Every dollar that I paid you, I made 100. Who wouldn't like that? For every dollar that I paid you, I made 100. So was this movie made for us?
No.
Were we in it?
Yes.
So we influenced, but did we control it?
No.
Go ahead.
But you gotta look at it from like a standpoint of the year, like a CEO of a company. You just had Get Out come out last year, and Get Out did numbers, right?
See,
like, I need another film that can touch the black community more. And not only just because Get Out is more safe, a more mature audience. But you want
want something that's universal, because like you can watch a Pixar movie or a Disney movie with anybody. So that's the whole thing of like when they're like writing this movie, like that's what they're trying to do. They're trying to capitalize on that. So they knew how much money they were going to make, but everybody else who's a cast member, they're like, oh, we're going to get a little bit of people watching, but they didn't know that it was going to be this much. But the people, like the mass amount behind the plan, like the white people, they knew what was going to happen just because the research that they did.
With everything that's going on.
Yeah, because you can see like when there's little like ripplings of like different ways that, so people, they know like Black Pride is starting to come back into the mainstream at least. So they're gonna capitalize on that.
Mm-hmm. Are they going to capitalize? Or are they also going to shape?
Yeah.
I would say because Black Panther is a movement. Because now the next one that comes out, they're probably gonna top it just because of the fact that Black people actually went out and seen it. It's like the highest paid Marvel movie. Now you have another one. That's like, it's like competition between Marvel movies and like people actually going to see movies. I'm pretty sure that I'm going to be racist, but white people are like, next Marvel movie come out, we're going to go see that and support that. But if you put Black Panther in that movie, that's also going to boost sales also.
But Infinity War is expected to like outdo that. Because that's literally everybody in Marvel.
Yeah, because this one is the closest they ever released like a Marvel movie together. Because usually they space them way further out, like whenever they release another movie.
Well, I wouldn't say necessarily per se, because you have like Amazing Spider-Man that came out right after the other.
Amazing
like,
Spider-Man didn't do as well though.
But you can still project by like how another movie is gonna do. And they know this, but like usually Marvel movies that happen like every like 6 to 9 months.
Yeah, and this one came out.
They got the Avengers and then they have the regular superhero movie.
With them releasing this one prior to obviously the next one, because he's gonna be in it, it's like they could capitalize more, because it's like after having this movie and everybody's like falling in love with him, the next movie is definitely gonna be even greater, because it's like, oh, my dog in there, like we gotta go.
Y'all gonna be disappointed because he's gonna be in the movie, but he ain't gonna be doing as much.
No, he's not.
He's really not.
He's not
gonna
play
just gonna
be a
supporting cast member. It's going to be a little bit of action, because if you watch Civil War, you're going to see where he was trying to chase after. I forgot who it was.
The Winter Soldier.
Yeah. He's coming back.
Well, he was at the end of the movie.
Yeah. And
at the end of Black Panther.
He's in Wakanda.
So like a new vibranium arm and everything.
Yeah.
You see, gotta go back, because once I start watching that, I had to go back and watch Captain America when he was digging for his shield. He asked about it was a circle one. He said, "What is that?" He said, "Made of vibranium," and that Tony Stark's father had found that. So you know, Iron Man's father has been in Wakanda already.
Well,
brought that over there. So that's why I saw when they was fighting in the first one. That's how Captain America knew his suit was made out of vibranium, because when he got shot, he said vibranium, and he asked him where he get it from. It was him and the soldier in the back seat.
You see that?
So you gotta watch all this stuff.
Which is gonna make more money for them, because then people want to go back and watch all the other movies to see what actually like led up to this.
Are those dollars going into black hands?
No.
You see how we were able to understand the whole Marvel universe and how Black Panther ties up in it, right? Where do you stand as a black woman, as a black man here in America? Maybe
not as well off as our counterparts.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
I'm gonna challenge that. Mm-hmm. Who came up with the theory of special and general relativity? His name was Albert. Last name
Einstein.
Einstein. Who came up with the theory of gravity? Sir Isaac Newton, right? Sir Isaac Newton, things that were phenomenal, right? That you transformational in modern day science, correct?
Mm-hmm.
Explain the pyramids to me. You that smart? Explain the pyramids to me.
Africans.
Time, we all fear time, but time fears the pyramids. For 5,000 years, the pyramids stood as the tallest human-made structure. 5,000. The next the tallest structure, guess what it was? Eiffel Tower. The pyramids were the tallest structure.
It's kind of shaped the same way, everything they based it off of it. Because it's the same shape and everything.
When you walk up to the pyramid, when you're, I had the opportunity to take my sister to Egypt in 2016. And we're driving in town, right? Little putt putt. Driving into town. And then it's like, you're like, we're pyramids. We turn a corner and you see, oh, there's the pyramids. And then you keep driving and you're like, okay, well, the pyramids are big. And you keep driving and you're like, well, we've been driving for 10 minutes. I've been still looking at the pyramids. Still looking at the pyramids. We get to our place, right? We get to our place. And I wish I would have brought the pictures with me, but I can share those with you later. We get to our place and we're literally across the street from the entrance to the pyramids. Every morning, it was like a bed and breakfast. Every morning, I get up, I have breakfast, and I'm looking direct. I'm having breakfast with the Sphinx looking at me and the pyramids looking at me. Right? You go up to the pyramids and you're like, yeah, these things are big. Then you get there and you're like, oh. People who look like me built this. Explain to me those pyramids. So we talk about Wakanda forever. Wakanda's always been here. It's in our DNA. It's hidden within there. What did Nielsen say? Her magic, our science, right? They're utilizing science to help understand the magic that is within our veins.
Because they went and stole it from there when they colonized them. They went and stole everything we know from
there.
That's
what I wondered. So I was like, maybe it might be like books on how the pyramid was built and it was stolen.
It was all stolen. Like most things that you see nowadays, like the math, the pyramids, and our sciences, like are the gold, utilizing the metals and stuff like that. It was stolen from Africa. Like they don't make up stuff, most of it though.
Not only stolen, but there's some parts of like our history that we just don't know just because they didn't want to document it because they didn't feel it was that important just because it's black people.
Okay. So I'd rather keep it from you. Not documented, but I'll tell you my own little story of what your history is, mm-hmm. about what your place in society is. Go ahead.
I heard the Egyptians knocked like the nose off of some of the pyramids because they look like us.
Napoleon the Great. Napoleon. Mm-hmm. Yes, Napoleon. That's they say. They say that they did some. They did some wild stuff. They did some wild stuff, especially when the Greeks and Romans came. When we went to Alexandria, which is north of Cairo, north of Giza. Alexandria is a port city, and we went into the catacombs. Mm-hmm. Now the Egyptians, the way they did the pyramids and the mastabas were basically their tombs, where they built underground. Me and my sister, when we were in the pyramids, had gotten inside the tomb and all that stuff. You know what I'm saying? Cheesing, taking pictures, all that stuff. Nothing. Right. Went to Alexandria, right? This is where the Greeks and Romans had really gotten a foothold. And we go into the catacombs. The catacombs are underground structures. But it's where they bury their dead. We go into the catacombs, and the first thing that you see in the catacombs after you go down maybe about 15, 20 feet, is you see there's this place where there were all these broken plates. What it was is that they would have a feast inside of there, right? Y'all eating around dead people around the next corner in the next room, and y'all had a party downstairs, okay? The deeper we went into the catacombs, the sicker I got. The deeper we went, there were certain parts my sister was like, nah, I'm not going. So the energy in that place was different. Here it is, something as beautiful and great as Alexandria, as Egypt, and why is this energy in this place so off versus when I was in the pyramids?
Because of how they died. Who they buried down there, actually.
What they was doing. Would you want to eat next to dead bodies? No. And you having a party down there. So I just want to give you some context about what has been stolen from us. And when I got back from Egypt, my tongues for a lot of stuff was that thin. Because I realized how I've been lied to, right? What had been kept from me. Yes, you can tell me everything that you want about, oh, yeah, we're landing spaceships vertically. That's dope, right? Explain the pyramids to me. Yes, you have the finest institutions and all that, right? But you burned down Timbuktu. yes, you have this great financial system, but you bombed Greenwood, Oklahoma. Tulsa, Oklahoma. Anybody heard of Black Wall Street?
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
Right? So now here it is, you tell me how big and great that I am, yet every time that I do something big and great, you either steal it, kill it, or destroy it. Where have I heard that before? The enemy comes to
steal,
kill, and destroy. So you've stolen my history. You've stolen my accomplishments. You've stolen my contributions to humankind. You've killed civilizations. You've destroyed civilizations. You've killed hope. So now here it is we're in 2018, and they tell you, hey, don't be angry. Go to school. Go to school. You should go to school. You should get your education. Don't be angry. Don't be mad. Don't go back into history. That was so long ago. What you mean that was so long ago? I'm just 50 years of being able to have the rights of a citizen.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, they always like to say it's history. You shouldn't be mad about it anymore. Like, slavery was a long time ago, and I'm like, that's not that long ago.
Was not that long ago. Five generations removed from slavery.
Mm-hmm.
Five. One, two, three, four, fifth.
Anybody remember that?
Yeah, absolutely. Absolutely. But five generations removed from slavery. So here it is I'm going to challenge each and every single last one of you to go out there and be your best, to do your best, to be unapologetic in being your best, regardless of how you have your hair, regardless of what kind of education that you have, regardless of what you are wearing. It seems that we are always seen threats. Yet, we're studied, we're put on television. Why is that? To shape the minds, to shape the narrative of everyone who was watching. As we already saw, that we thought that Black-ish was maybe a black show, but 80% viewership was non-black.
We're trying to, they try to describe the narrative of black people. When the media, they try to create their own definition of how we live. And when they do that by writing the scripts and showing everybody in publicity everything that they do about us.
Absolutely.
Well, just like that other show that they just brought out with the Biggie and Tupac, they doing their story on, was it TNT or USA? They always want to create the narrative and pretend like go back and say, oh, well, we can rewrite what was done. But the reality is, it's like you're trying to make it seem like what happened didn't happen.
It pertains to what we're talking about, but it doesn't. But like how they're so interested in our like everything and our lifestyle, but like if it's something that we're doing that's better than them, like they completely undermine it. Like the kid that applied to like 30 different schools.
Oh yeah,
and got that goal. Accepted 20 different schools and got accepted in all of them, and then he got put on, I forgot which,
Fox.
I think it was Fox, and they were like, I don't understand why he applied. He's just taking all these spots for other potential students. He could have just,
he didn't take their spots, he was accepted.
And I'm like, let that have been a little white boy, though. It wouldn't have been all that. Y'all would have been celebrating him instead of trying to undermine his success. Because that's really amazing that he got into like Princeton, Harvard.
Any school he wanted.
Absolutely. So therefore, should I be worried about the validation of those who do not share my cultural, ethnic, or racial history? Who cannot relate to my experience as somebody black in America, as a descendant of enslaved Africans? Should I be worried about what they have to say?
And they try to make it seem, well, they try to make it to manipulate like the mindset of people and say, well, we have the power, we're the controlling power right now, so you should care what we do. Like if somebody black speaks out, you'll see another white person come behind them, or they'll use a black person, like a pastor or something, come up behind them and undermine what they just did, saying, well, he's creating conflict, you're making a worse situation. Like, I cannot remember his name.
Ndjaka, as you can see, I am not dead, and I never yielded. What you mean you never yielded? I threw you off the cliff, off the side of the cliff. If my mama wouldn't have came and gave you the heart-shaped herb, you'd be dead in that right now, player. So I had somebody coming up behind and undermining everything that I was doing. Right? One example of that is when we start talking about one of the major issues I did not like with the movie was that it was okay for the CIA agent to shoot down those planes. When they were trying to leave out with the weapons. Mm-hmm. It was that dangerous that black folks all around the country have, all around the world have those weapons, that T'Challa was willing to allow somebody white, right? A colonizer, a foreign spy, kill his own people.
You saw how determined he was to stay there even though he was being shot out from the outside when they were flying down to try and stop and shoot the plane down.
Absolutely. Absolutely. So I just challenge
you. I feel
like
that was for the white people, though.
It was.
It's like, it's because when you're first watching it, it's kind of like, oh, well, he's helping. But at the same time, that's what a lot of white people's mindset is. Like, they don't see the wrongness in what they're doing, but then it's like, it's kind of like this, like, oh, well, my friend's black, so I'm not racist, type.
I hate when people say that, like, that does not mean what you think
it means.
It
was kind of like it's for them to have their peace point in the movie.
I think that it does matter. You want to hear why? Ever get in the elevator and somebody clench up their purse?
Mm-hmm.
Why can't I do the same thing? Why can't I be like, y'all still people? So, you know what I'm saying? Same way you worry about me. Y'all still people.
Right.
I don't have to be validated by your fears. I don't have to be validated by your applause. I don't have to be invalidated by your narrative or by your message. Mm-hmm. So, thank you. Thank you for spending over $370 million on this movie, right? And having a black cast. But next time that it needs to be done, next time that it's done, guess what? The black actors need to be paid. As a matter of fact, I wish that I was in a position where now I can not only finance my own films, right? Star my own films, finance my own films, distribute my own films. And we have that now.
So they did
a lot of
that fight scene with the Tyler Perry Studios.
Yeah. Tyler Perry Studios. When we get to a point where we're able to market, our own material, we're able to distribute our own material, we now have greater control over it. Go ahead.
But like when you look back in culture, like black people, like even though they'll support something, they haven't always supported it with their money. Because we see like now that hip hop is like the most popular genre or whatever you say, but way back we had all these people rapping, but every time they put out an album, we aren't the ones buying it. When they go have a show, we're not the ones there. That's why now when you go to shows, you can go watch Migos at a show, but you're gonna see a whole bunch of white kids. And not necessarily to say like that's just because we don't support, sometimes the prices are too much and everybody isn't able to, but I'm just like, we need to be able to support more too, because we put a lot of people on, but we don't always support those people. Because that little yodeling boy in Walmart, black people literally helped him skyrocket because all the memes were made by black people. So we have enough power to put people,
dude, just got put, a whole concert and everything.
Yeah, we got
Walmart.
The power to put people like in a higher tier, but we don't necessarily always do it or support the right people at the same time. Just in general, whether it be with arts, whether it's like a restaurant, whatever it is, we just don't always support it. We support it a lot with our mouths, but not with action. So.
Oh, wait, were you? Okay.
Well, that's to tie into what he was saying, because they said, I was looking up something, they said black people will have $1.5 trillion in buying power by 2020. So that's the time we have the power. Like, we buy the stuff and everything. It's just who we are supporting is what matters. To tie into what you were saying. And then, if you didn't notice, they also released Tyler Perry's other movie, Acrimony, right after like Black Panther came out, and you saw they made a black woman. She was crazy. She wanted to kill, so they made it look like just this psychotic person. Like, they had two sides of a coin when those movies were coming out, so.
So I'm utilizing movies as a way of also pushing a greater agenda. Agreed? Why, you know, you would think that movies are like, oh, well, it's just a movie, but movies are so powerful. Mm-hmm.
Right.
A lot of
people got mad about Get Out. They got mad.
I mean, and the whole narrative of the movie period, movies are originally used as like war propaganda and everything. So, I mean, that's really like usually in like certain countries, like Japan and everything, they have like the only movies they will play is like war movies, like, and just so that it's literally propaganda, like it's world propaganda. So people can see that. How they're trying to portray certain things in the world.
What you're talking about is something, anybody heard of information warfare? Mm-hmm. Anybody heard of psychological warfare? Mm-hmm. Can you give me a definition? Mm-hmm. What would you consider information warfare? Let me say
I don't know.
Oh, you don't know what information warfare is? Okay. You heard of it though. Okay. Information warfare. Let's give a great example of some information warfare. Kevin Hart, when he got caught cheating with some scribbles. Right? And now all of a sudden you see all those memes, all the memes come up, right? Mm-hmm. If I was a bad actor, if I was somebody who was intent on destroying his career, I could utilize those memes as information warfare.
Well, they're saying the same thing now with the guy that's with Khloe Kardashian, saying he's serious.
Sure, well, that, I wouldn't necessarily say it bad, because last time he cheated on his pregnant wife, they won a championship. So.
Oh, my God.
Nah, you did not. That's a secret sauce. Black men don't cheat 2018. Oh, go ahead.
I'm done with you. Oh, Lord.
I got to play devil's advocate in here.
Yeah, you get them.
Oh, yeah, that's it.
I'm not getting into grown folks' business. But what we're talking about is information warfare, right? So the same way that movies and information can be part of a campaign, a warfare campaign, we have weaponized movies, right? We have weaponized movies. We have utilized movies to attack certain pieces of the human ego of the human psyche.
Yeah, they all have messages now, and like depending on what message you're trying to put out there, depends on how people are how it's gonna do.
Isn't that marketing?
Mm-hmm.
Mm-hmm. Mm. So if I'm marketing to you, I don't have to just market to sell you something as a physical product, can I? I can now market to you to sell to you ideas and behaviors.
And like if you pay attention to Black Panther, a lot of the characters that were in the movie were like flat characters. They're like one dimensional. Like that kind of, because they show you Killmonger's aggression, but they don't. They kind of like, it's almost like what you call it, iceberg effect, where you kind of know why he's aggressive, but they don't truly show you everything why. So like, if you're a white person watching it, you're like, oh, this is just another angry Black man, but you don't understand the true reasons behind it.
Angry Black man wearing boots, right? Wearing boots with military hardware, military gear. I don't know if you guys see my backpack. Everybody see my backpack in the back? What does my backpack look like? Military, right? So, and I have an Osama bin Laden beard. What do you think people think when they see me?
Angry!
I get that all the time. Right? And my response to them is like, well, I'm a student of history. I should be angry. I should be highly educated. I should be dangerous. You see me as a threat? Why not be dangerous? Right? Is anything wrong necessarily with, let's say, in an atomic bomb? Is anything patently wrong with an atomic bomb? Is an atomic bomb dangerous?
Yes.
Right? Is an atomic bomb going to blow up by itself?
No.
Okay, only when a specific set of stimuli and circumstances happen does that atomic bomb now release what's within it. Mm-hmm. So if I'm told at all given times that, you know, I should cut my beard, I should talk differently, I should walk differently, but you're going to see me as a threat regardless because of my skin, I might as well be dangerous, be peaceful, right? I'm blessed. I'm peaceful. I'm productive. I'm dangerous when I need to be.
Exactly. Like, people, like, you get mad, they, like, and you're black, like, me, like, they, like, I'm nice most of the time unless you push me to a certain point. And then people take that as, oh, my goodness, they just think you're coming out of pocket. I'm like, no, it's something that built up. I don't just automatically going to jump to some conclusion.
Yep, they automatically.
Yeah. This is where I feel like, understanding that the marketing and the promotion for Black Panther, but like if you, and it was an all black cast, but you think about like Birth of a Nation. And if we, and if, you know, like, you know, certain schools and the way it's being taught is like they want to forget about slavery. And they don't really, like, we don't market slavery. So some people say, even black folks say, I don't want to see another slave movie, I don't want to see another hurt movie, but at the same time, a lot of people are trying to forget about it, and due to like how the news manipulates black history, schools manipulate black history. Like you just said, we just trying to celebrate our 50 years of, you know, basically freedom. So I feel like the same marketing plan should be used for that. So like the younger generations of black people could understand where, you know, where the older people are coming from.
So they don't forget, they need to make exactly. It in a way that the youth is gonna actually receive it, because they can't come at it the same way that they used to in older generations, where they could just like talk about it and it showed
it was for us.
Yeah.
Let me ask this question.
That was
for you.
Do the Jews ever allow us to forget the Holocaust?
Never.
Okay. So why should we allow anybody to forget slavery? Let me add some more stuff onto this, right? We talk about this black wealth gap, right? But what we do not talk about is how land was stolen from black folks here in America. Mm-hmm. There's a book called The Land Was Ours, a story of African American beaches. Manhattan Beach in California is like prime real estate It's on the beach, right?
Yeah.
They used to be black people. They lived there. Mm-hmm. Land was stolen. It was called Bruce's Beach before it was Manhattan Beach. So now when I'm looking at young black people, I'm looking at young black people, I'm like, oh goodness gracious. I know that there's tensions rising. I know there's tensions rising. 2014 we had Ferguson, right? 2015 with Baltimore, right? 2016 we had Dallas, right? We had Dallas and Baton Rouge, right? We had a lot of things going on during this time, this great awakening of younger black folks, right?
And another one just happened.
Oh, no, that's been happening.
Oh, that's been happening. Yeah.
Every time something happens.
I'm saying to you is if I look at these things that are within this time frame, right? I look at the movies that are within this time, and I see you kill off N'Jobu and T'Chaka's father, who was trying to help black folks, right? Mm-hmm. I see you do that in the movie. I see you kill N'Jobu, somebody who was angry and rightfully so, right now trying to help those oppressed people all around the world, and I now see these social movements. How does that influence my behavior as somebody black and young?
They're gonna like kind of stir in the pot. They're gonna create a situation where it's gonna blow up in their face. If the youth take it in their hands and actually use what they've seen, use what they learned, use their history, and use it in a way that's gonna bring about a change.
Absolutely. Any more comments? I just find it very interesting. Very, very, very interesting that we as black folks, we are at an inflection point in our history. We're here in the promised land right now. Right? Martin Luther King Jr. said that, you know, I've seen the promised land, we're here. The old guard and old leadership and decision makers, many of them are dying off and transitioning out, and this is really our time. Therefore, at no such time more critical than this has it been necessary for us to choose what direction that we're going to do, what direction we're going to go, and what we're going to do with our lives. We should be unapologetic about the things that we do, about the things that we say. What, the things that we say and the way that we feel is well justified and well documented. Therefore, I shouldn't be worried about what anybody else has to say about me, because history speaks for itself, right? I'm going to do everything in my power to take back what was stolen from me. Is it stealing if I'm taking back what was stolen from me?
No.
No.
It feels like there is OJ for taking back his stuff.
Absolutely. Absolutely. So this is what we're doing now, is we're taking back what's stolen from us. It doesn't stop with education. It doesn't stop with finances. It doesn't stop with physicality. It doesn't stop with religion. It starts with everything. And only when we decide to make those changes in our lives, both financially, physically, spiritually, mentally, when we make those changes, that's when we can actually see the change that we want to see. We think that violence or conflict is in and of itself bad, but how was this country founded?
Guns, germs, and steel.
Violence and revolution. Agreed?
Mm-hmm.
It was a revolutionary war that allowed us to have a constitution and a bill of rights. It was a civil war that allowed for me to stop being considered as property, even though I never, go ahead, the rule's right there for you, Queen. Even though I was never really considered, never stopped looking, being looked up as property. And granted, when we look at the Bill of Rights, we can go down the line and see which ones we've been denied of, right? So I'm saying for us as young black people in America, it is imperative, it is our duty, it is our right, it is necessary that we exercise all rights that we have, unapologetically, both civil rights, but also our human rights. So when somebody tells me, oh, you shouldn't be angry, you shouldn't be angry, I say to deny me anger is like denying me sadness. If you deny me sadness, you're denying me humanity. Therefore, if anger and sadness go together, or anger and sadness are part of the human psyche and human emotions, to say for me to stop doing any of those is to tell me to stop being human. And what if you just reduce me to less than human, or you made me property? So when we see and we hear how people talk about us as black folks in America, we have to be very conscious of this and be clear that, look, this is the direction that I want to go, and this is what you're telling me, and this is the things that are up against me, but guess what? I descend from the people who created the pyramids. I descend from the oldest people, the first people on earth. The first. That's one of the reasons why we always believe in humanity. We believe why Martin Luther King Jr. was so prolific, was because he understood that by believing in humanity meant believing in black people. If black people gave up humanity, they were giving up on themselves. Why? Because we created humanity. So, I think now at this point in time in our history that we have to reevaluate whether or not Martin Luther King Jr. should still be the gold standard of okay, absolutely. Well, Dr. Powell's telling me that I have ran my time, but I thank you so much for your time.
Thank you.